Afternoon, our esteemed guest, our Executive President, Dr. Mangesh Karan sir, my distinguished and learned colleagues from MIT EDT University. It's a great pleasure for me to stand before you. We have with us Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj, a distinguished scientist. He's a Marie Curie Fellow Researcher, Medical Science Division, University of Oxford. At the outset, on behalf of MIT EDT University, I wish to extend a very warm and hearty welcome to Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj, who is with us today to share his experience specifically in his own field of cancer. And he would be also talking to us on multidisciplinary research approach and opportunities, a way forward. And in fact, as a policy of MIT EDT University, we all know that our executive president keeps us telling us about research, but not only just research, but research which should be a cross-disciplinary, multidisciplinary. And of course, that's the order of the day. And fortunately, on MIT EDT University campus, we have 14 plus institutions. And obviously, institutions which cater to management, engineering, technology, bioscience, in terms of performing arts, music, drama. So it's a rare combination that is there on our campus. And obviously, there is a plenty of opportunity for all of us to do multidisciplinary research at this particular place. So obviously, it's our great fortune that we have with us Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj, who would tell us about that multidisciplinary research opportunities. And obviously, his talk would certainly enrich all of us. Just to begin with, of course, I would like to extend a welcome to all of you and to our guest. And briefly, I would like to mention about a few of those salient points about Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj, who has completed his Bachelor of Science. I think he's from physics, he was telling me just before. And then from physics, he has moved to the medical field. So he is a Bachelor of Science graduate from Shivaji University in 2006. Then he did his Master of Science in 2008 from same Shivaji University, as I said, in physics, and completed his Doctor of Philosophy with gold medal, again in physics, from Center of Interdisciplinary Research from D.Y. Patil University, Kolhapur. And post his education, he has worked as lecturer of engineering physics at D.Y. Patil College, and then he moved on to Samsung Institute Research Fellow, Samsung Biomedical Research Institute School of Medicine, South Korea, and then Irish Research Council, postdoctoral fellow in Ireland, and subsequently is a research fellow from Bernal Institute, University of Limerick, Ireland. As I mentioned earlier, presently he is a Marie Curie Fellow Research Scientist at University of Oxford. So I think this is, he has of course won several awards also. It's a long resume and profile Dr. Thoraj has, and probably it would take a session for me to speak about his achievements and accomplishments. But I would like to restrict myself. We wish we all are eager to hear him. So with this brief introduction, I present, it's my pleasure to present Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj to all of you. Thank you. I would like to request Honorable Dr. Mangesh Karan sir to felicitate our guest, Dr. Nanasaheb Thoraj. So I request now Dr. Nana Saheb Thorat to take on the dais and enrich us, enlighten us.
It's my great privilege and great opportunity to be with you. I'm very much thankful, Mr. Mangeshkar sir and his team, for inviting me to the MIT campus. I'm the basic scientist who is working in some basic fundamental science. We also do some inventions. And along with the research, I also work for the policy makings for European Commission and United Kingdom Cancer Research Foundation and with some UK government agencies. So I'll be not going with my all introduction and other things. I'll be more focusing today on the role of universities and how we can establish interdisciplinary research that is much needed now for every institute. Most of the universities, just before the talk, I was talking with the Karat sir and we discussed that we have around 10 universities around the Pune, and in Maharashtra around more than 20 private universities, more than 10 deemed universities, and more than 15 state and agriculture universities, 3 to 5 central institutes, IIT, ICERS. So Maharashtra has a rich educational culture, environment, but still we are lacking in the research. So the investment done by the private or the state or the central institutes and the output is really a reciprocal. So it's time to focus on the balancing research and academics, because when institute, it's not just for the research, their main focus is the academics, because their main input is the students, and they have to show the result to students in terms of their quality of education and their jobs. But at the same time, if we focus on the research, we can get the quality students. So I'll be today focusing on the how we can nourish that kind of culture. And we don't need a very talented people in the research. That's my belief. Even we don't need the 80-90% students for researcher. And because they are focused on the jobs, because society has the mindset, they always bother them that if you have such scores, such marks, why are you going for the basic science fundamentals or research where we don't have future? Let's go for engineering, medical, you'll get a great job, great packages and something. So all the researchers, they are very, very in the middle range. They are just a normal students, including me. I myself, Nana Saheb Thorat, so I work with the two institutes. One is the University of Oxford and another is the European Commission. So European Commission is a body, bureaucratic body of the 28 countries, and UK just left from the European Union, but still it is for the research. So we get funded from the European Commission and we work in the University of Oxford. Yeah. So University of Oxford is situated near London. It's just 1 hour from the London. Oxford is the city, very famous city. And it's not just a campus-based university. So most of the European universities, they have campuses all over the city. So this is Oxford City and Oxford University as well. So we can't distinguish where is the university buildings, where are the mall, shopping center, residential complexes. And these all buildings are around 500, 600 years old, not a new buildings. And they have very good constructions, architectures. So Oxford has around 80 different departments, divisions, more than 120 labs, library, which is very famous, one of the world's most famous library. Sometimes it is called the Harry Potter Library as well. So they have around 12,000 research and teaching staff, 30,000 students, and around not only just the research focused, but they are making the leaders. And we can see here 40 countries' prime minister were educated from the Oxford, including Manmohan Singh, Indira Gandhi, and 27 prime ministers of UK, they are educated from the Oxford. Even now, Joe Biden's minister, seven ministers are from Oxford. They also have around 80 Nobel laureates. Currently, around 14 Nobel laureates are teaching and doing research in the Oxford. Every year, they grant around 500 patents, US patents, European patents, and international patents. More than 10 Center of Technology Transfers, Innovation Departments, Invention Departments. That's why it is number one in all rankings. Somewhere it is number two in QS and number one in Times Higher. And the research budget is around 3,000 to 4,000 crore rupees. And overall budget is around 10,000 crore rupees. So why it is? Because of it is old university. It's established around 1,000 years ago. And over the time, they focused on the academics and research. Many inventions came through the Oxford. And one of the life-saving inventions of the Oxford is the vaccine. So the vaccine that is now 3 billion people who get vaccinated with a Covishield, or we can call the Oxford AstraZeneca. That was developed by the scientist Sarah Gilbert, who is affiliated with our same division, medical science, and more than 300 researchers working in her team to develop vaccines. So they developed around 10 vaccines already, and two are marketed now. Malaria and dengue will be coming in next 3 to 4 years. Some cancer vaccines will be coming in next 10 years. So they have rich research culture and rich academics as well. So along with the Oxford, I work with the Union and European Commission. So the European Commission, I told, is a bureaucratic body of the European Union, which is a group of 28 countries. And they came together on three principles: culture, science, and the freedom. And still they believe on that. Now UK left because of their political agenda, but still they are in for the research, because research is not, nobody claims that research is somebody's invention or somebody can claim that this is my research. No, research don't have any borders, religions, or any nationalities. And that's why they are in the. So we have the headquarters in Brussels, Belgium. I got funded from last 4 years by the European Commission, and I work with some European Commission scientific missions, like a cooperation in science and technology, where we work with more than 250 scientists, 4 Nobel laureates, 28 countries' health ministers. And we are now developing the health policy, cancer health policy for the Europe for next 50 years. So screening, testing, or diagnosis and therapeutics, which is a 50% weightage, and 50% weightage to stop the spread of cancer. So making the awareness. So such kind of policy, we have drafted more than 1,000 page documents for this cancer policy. And we are not just drafted it, we have submitted to the all ministers and prime ministers of these countries. And now they started to implement these ideas. So research or screening, now every year, Europe will screen more than 10 lakh people for cancer. So 1 million people every year they will screen for the cancer. And their aim is to stop the cancer almost around 30% to 40% by 2030. Very ambitious aim, but they are heading towards that. Along with the research and policy making, I also provide the service to universities to establish internationally accredited, international level research centers, academic centers, which is the need of time for all universities, especially in India. So our universities are divided in three categories. I will call it is a layers or tier system. So tier one means most of the IITs who has reached for funding. So crore of rupees they get from the HRD or the government of India. Then tier two comes in the state universities who are funded by state or some central universities. And tier three, they are mostly private universities. They are struggling for the research. They are good in academics, but they are struggling for the research. Even IITs, they are good in academics, but they are struggling for the research. They are making good students or faculties. But innovations, we are lagging too much, even in IITs. Department of Science and Technology, our Indian governments, they have around more than 6,000 crore rupees budget for the research. More than 70% budget is grabbed by the IITs. And rest 30% comes for central universities, some central institutes, state universities, private universities, deemed universities, and then colleges. So this is a huge barrier for such tier three institutes. And it's time to make them self-sufficient for research. Even now, central government pushing all IIT in central institute to bring some money from private industries or kind of charities. But this is kind of difficult task, like Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. They are developing the fundamental knowledge, how they can bring the money from industry, because not they don't make any invention. They do the some kind of fundamental research. Nobody is interested. Probably that research will be used after 20 or 30 years. So this is something, a mismatch between the policies and the reality. Most of the European countries, US, Australia, Japan, and Korea, and even China, they have a good policy for such kind of research. They have equal weightage for fundamental research as well as the applied research. So even I have PhD in physics, it's mostly in fundamental, but now I am developing some cancer therapies, which is applied knowledge. So I will have equal opportunities there for fundamental as well as the applied. That's why, because of the nature of interdisciplinary actions and your ideas, innovations, and of course your skills. So all universities now it's time to think. You have to make your domains so they can think out of box for the research and academics as well. So because now research means most of the faculties or the university bureaucrats, they think that research means something that can be done only in the laboratory, and we have to just invest something there, fund there, make available some infrastructure. No, there is something. Even you are collecting the data, analyzing the data, that means also a kind of research. So we have to think in that way. When we come to the world's best universities, I have been working with not only with Oxford scientists, but the Harvard Medical School. I work with the Yale Medical School or Cambridge University, ETH Zurich from Switzerland, or Zurich University, Switzerland. And when we think why they are the best, what are their policies? It's just because of the infrastructure or the faculties? No. There is something different there, and that is the human resource policies. Most of the industries, they have HR policies, but almost 90% institutes in India, they don't have the HR policies. And if we don't place the good HR policy, we don't bring the good faculties, infrastructure, students as well. So all these big universities, they are rich in HR policies. They know how to treat the faculty, they know how to treat the layer one faculty and layer four faculty, or students or researchers across the world. So like Oxford has around 70% researcher from the different countries. They are not UK nationals, but they have the equal right like all UK nationals. Those are working with us. So means their HR policies are well established and recognized, and most of the universities in the world, they follow these HR policies that was developed by Oxford, Cambridge, or Harvard, Stanford, or MIT in US. Because they think ahead of the future. And that's why they have the good researcher in their campuses. They know their roles. So what they know, that's learning and development, that is the academics, and that is the basics, fundamental stone for every institutes across the globe. Next is the discovery of knowledge. I will call the research and inventions. This is most important. Transmission and transfer of knowledge. Even we are lacking in this, transfer of knowledge. So I'll come to that, and community engagement. We are lacking in that sense as well. So our researcher, they work in the lab, but they don't make the outreach activities, dissemination of their research to the common people. So that's why common people always think that these researchers, scientists are crazy, they are not good human being, or they are not for us. So they are just for research and for research. But the scenario is changing. So I work with many small children in the schools because I work on the brain cancer of pediatric patients, small children. So I go into the schools, I make the presentation, activities, workshop to these school children and aware them about the cancer and the future of the health. So this kind of activities we have to improve in India. Right now some Indian funding like DST or the DBT, they are now mandating these activities, community engagement activities, and we must do that. So then people will recognize us, people will believe on us. When we talk about the invention and innovation, these words always play a major role. Intellectual activity, IPR rights. So now in India, many universities, they are organizing workshops, schools to aware the faculties what is the exact IPR and how we can deal with that. Yeah, let's start to a basic example. If some institute or university want to start such kind of multidisciplinary research culture, it's not just thinking or just making papers. We need discussions. We need faculties who are interested, because research we can't do with some gun on head that do research and solve the problem of or discover the vaccine for Delta plus strain, or discover the drug for cancer, or go in the space. No, we need discussion. We need time. We need patience. And that comes through our ideas. Every day we think from the morning to the night, we do the multitasking. And that means we are doing some interdisciplinary things in our brain. So brain is the origin of our all ideas and research activities. So we can't say just who are working in the lab, they are researcher. But the people who always thinking, doing multitasking, they are also researchers. Well, when we call that research, if it is well documented and well proven and criticized by the peers. So if I say I have some vaccine which is used for the Delta plus, I have to show it, I have to prove it. And if I want to prove it, I have to be criticized by someone who is expert in my field. Otherwise, I will go in the wrong direction, like HIV vaccines. So US, they did the, you know, very conspiracy with the HIV vaccines. They developed such vaccines and they made a trial in African countries. And later on they found that those who took the HIV vaccines, they are getting more infection than those who don't get it. And then they stopped that project. So it's because it is not criticized by the peers. So we can't do such kind of research. Otherwise, we will go in the wrong direction for humanity or environment or technology as well. So setting with the research in interdisciplinary, two or more fields come together, people or the ideas, they have to think new concepts with the fundamental methodology, and from that we must to be come with a new technology as well. Otherwise it will be a routine research. Just in two slides before, I mentioned about the two-way knowledge transfer. So when we talk about the two-way knowledge transfer, first get to know about what is one-way knowledge transfer and what is the one knowledge transfer. Knowledge transfer means what I have, I'm transferring to the others. Like I'm presenting today, it is a one-way knowledge transfer because I'm just presenting, you all are listening. So what I'm presenting, most of them you are believing that, okay, what he is presenting is correct. It is a one-way knowledge transfer. And our Indian system, it is 99% dominated with the one-way knowledge transfer. In education, in politics, in bureaucracy, everywhere, even in our home, we have leader and we have to, you know, obey his rules and regulations. So this is one-way knowledge transfer. Sometimes it's good, but for research, it's not good. We always have a two-way knowledge transfer. So the two-way knowledge transfer comes with a discussion, criticism. So in research, we believe on the two-way knowledge transfer. Whatever I'm claiming, whatever my ideas must be criticized by peers or even non-experts. This is going to be work or not work, or your technology is proven or not proven, or what your ideas you are proposing will have some hurdles in the future. European Commission, every project what we wrote for the European Commission or European Union, we have to write the two-way knowledge transfer. So two-way knowledge transfer between student and the faculty, faculty and the institute, then institute to the faculty, and then faculty to the student. And for that, we have to make a discussions, criticism, and all other things, all other ways by which we can make the two-way knowledge transfer. So all 100% activities in the European Union and all countries in Europe, they believe on the two-way knowledge transfer. And that's why we got the Covishield vaccine freely in India. So you will surprise how it is responsible. This one task, that whole world got the Covishield or the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine in very low price. The story starts when the vaccine developed by the Sarah Gilbert and her group in Oxford. So Sarah Gilbert, biochemist, she has her own startup. She's making some drugs using her company. So she proposed that our vaccine is ready. Now we have animal trials ready and trial phase one safety efficacy trials are ready. Now I will start to make the vaccine and produce it. And I will give the 30% share for the Oxford University. I will take 70%, whatever may be the profit. And initially Oxford University agreed for that. Okay, no problem. But there are some scientists in Oxford University. When the scientists in vaccine department presenting their ideas to the university, then other scientists from different departments, even from language, humanities, social sciences, or the business management, they opposed that. Why? They said, okay, you developed a vaccine, we are proud of you. But who supported you? Who funded you for this vaccine development? It's government. It's government money. So who gives for the government? It's taxpayers. So it's taxpayers' money. Now it is the time for the humanity to survive. And we are making the business from that. So this is not a good sign for the university. University is not mean for that. We are not an industry. We are the university. We are generating the knowledge, fundamentals. We have 1,000 of years of rich history, and now we are selling vaccine means we will be a businessman. This is not a university role. And after discussions and this kind of two-way knowledge transfer activities, at the end, Oxford University decided we will sign the contract with the different company who will make the vaccines in no profit and no loss base. And then the one US company came forward, then there was no some legal issues. Then AstraZeneca, the Swedish company, he agreed that we will provide 3 billion doses, 300 crore doses, I would say, no profit, no loss to the world. Not only UK, Europe, but the India, Brazil, Mexico, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and all African countries, all third world countries, all the developing countries. And because of that one meeting, the price was decided. How much is the production cost for one dose? It is around $2 or £2, 200 rupees, less than 200 rupees. And with the transportation and other cost, it cost in India around 250 rupees. While in Europe, it is 150 rupees. In UK, it is free, all free vaccines there, but government is buying that. So if this kind of culture is there in universities or institutes, they can change the world. Otherwise, if that was not happen, it might be, in the today's scenario, we have to buy the Covishield or the Covaxin or other vaccines for 2,000 or 3,000 rupees. Okay, we are common man, we can take it. For our family, we can spend around 10,000 rupees. But the people in the very poor region, just yesterday I had a meeting or the ceremony in Sangli, which is the most poorest region in the Maharashtra. They can't afford that. So this is the beauty of science and scientist and the university. And universities are meant to be that. While Pfizer also have the same kind of strategy, when the Oxford and AstraZeneca reduced their price, these all other revivals, they reduced their price, including the Sputnik or Covaxin or Johnson, two new are coming from GSK and other one company. So all they are affordable to common man as well as the government, because government can afford the high price as well. So when we invest in the science, it's not for a short-term investment or the short-term output. We have to think for the next 20 year or 30 year, we will get a breakthrough after 20, 30 year. So how much Oxford University lost in this deal? More than 1 lakh crore rupees. If they buy this vaccine or they sell this vaccine, even with a 20% of margin profit, they can get around 1 lakh crore of rupees. But they don't care it because they care for their name. Harvard, MIT in USA or the other universities, they always prefer their names and symbols through the education, human resource policies, and the research. So this kind of culture we need in India as well. Otherwise, we will buy the technology from Germany or Japan. We will make something here, but it will be not our. And it's unfortunate truth for us, because we don't have such kind of culture. Criticism, that what we need in our education system, in academics, we are lagging in that. And that's why people believe that Europeans are very far, very ahead for human resource. And this is the one of the example. There are so many. Well, if some institutes want to tie up with some different faculties together, like MIT here, so you have the faculties from engineering and humanities. But if you arrange one program for the engineering faculty, humanities faculty don't come. Students don't come. Because they will, we are not engineer. We'll be treated as the third person there. So we will not come in there. This is the bitter truth here. And when they arrange some, engineers don't go there. They say it's not for ours. But they don't think that humanities means our life and it's for us. But it's a mismatch, a barrier between the faculties in the same institutes. Even they sit together, they talk together, they are friends, but they don't share that ideas. It's time now to share it. In this one institute, if you have such kind of faculties, it's time to tie up them together Similarly, like other big universities, Harvard, Stanford, or Cambridge, they are rich in such kind of multidisciplinary cultures. And it's not just from last 10 years or 20 years, they have 1,000 years of histories. Or some universities like MIT in USA, they have 200 years of history, but they are the best for human resource policies. Well, most of the faculties, universities, they want to do research, but they don't know what to prefer for researchers, what they prefer. What they need, what researchers need, they need the time. They want time first. Money is the second priority. First, they need time. And unfortunately, we don't have. All, it's university, but I'm working with some medical schools as well in India. Even they don't give me a 1 minute of their, you know, from busy schedule. So we are not even in, if we rank the all countries in the world for medical research, India will be below 50. Because all doctors are very active, they are practitioners, they get 200 patients daily. But unfortunately, they are not researcher. They are not critical thinker. They don't analyze their own data. They don't make reports. So all doctors in Germany or USA or UK, they are researcher. They always think, when I'm treating someone, he's my laboratory animal. He's not my patient. He's my laboratory animal. I will judge, I will treat him, and will analyze him as well. And then we'll choose another therapeutics for different patient. Unfortunately, we don't have that culture. It's come through the education, not we can't, the same like heading the gun. Just do that analysis and do the research for doctors. They will say, I don't get money for that. I don't have time for that. But we have to change that. So we have to give them fewer administrative tasks, time for discussions, or writing projects for government agencies, or those are in engineering fields, they can write. Approach industries for budget, money, better use of time. Now UGC has recommended for all universities to set up the international research office. So if you are recruiting some international students, you are sending your faculties or students to international institutes, you have to be set up one research office who will deal such international policies, who will guide faculties. We need such kind of offices in each universities. Most of the US and all other universities where I worked, they have such kind of departments who are dealing with the faculties, international faculties and students. And moral, that's the most important. Don't give the money, don't give the salary even. Many researchers in UK, they don't have salary, but they work in the labs because they have that kind of moral support from the institutes and their colleagues. So sometimes it works. So the vaccine developed by the Pfizer, the lady who proposed such kind of mRNA therapeutics, she worked kind of a daily wages worker in US university for 30 years. So, and now she is a billionaire. So it's commitment and moral support. Sometimes our situation is playing the most crucial role as well. So I met more than 1,000 researchers across the globe and never have an issue with researchers. They are claiming they are complaining about their salaries. They always complain about the infrastructure and opportunities. They say we are happy with that because we have the freedom that others didn't get, like IT guys, doctors, they can make the crores rupees. But they don't, they have Mercedes, they have BMWs, but they are parked for whole month in their apartments. And we have the time with our Suzuki car, we can go every day for driving. We can go to the pubs or to meet families, to attend the gatherings or functions of families. Even I have around 60 days of vacation. So these engineers, they don't get. So we have the freedom. If we don't have salary, we have freedom, so we can utilize our life as well. So morally, that play an important role. Another one, most crucial field in Indian context is the equality, equity, and liberation in research as well. Here you can see the equality means what? I don't need to explain everything. The image is equity means look, but what liberation? So everyone have equal access. We need it in research. Even in a mainline media, I wrote almost 80 articles in many medias, including Sakal, Lokmat, to Times of India. I have many interviews in ABP and Lokmat and all other TV channels. And many times I say to these anchors that you know the politics of the politicians. You don't know the politics of the science. Come to the science institutes, central institutes, go visit, take interviews of faculties. You will understand how politically ruled institutes are. So we don't have liberation in our institutes. It is the same in across the world. Not India is much, but even in UK, Germany, they have that. But most of the time, it is not more than 5%. They have equal opportunities and liberation. So this kind of culture, if we have such kind of culture, I'm sure researcher will work freely in the research institutes. They will not ask you the money, they will ask you just infrastructure. Well, this part is about the universities, their role, and what kind of culture we need. Now I'll come towards how we can develop the interdisciplinary research faculty with my own example. So I have a little bit expertise, not whole, in physics. I forget about the Newton laws and classical or quantum physics. But now I can understand the molecular biology, chemistry, biochemistry, microbiology, cancer biology, vaccines, their platforms, and others. So it's a journey from physics to chemistry, then biology, then medicine, and I'm now working with a hospital. We are treating the women and who has a post-delivery syndromes or pre-delivery syndromes. Even I don't have any clinical degree or expertise. That's the another beauty of the researcher. So you can get the equal opportunities to work with them. So I just have a simple career profile. 12 science, Bachelor of Science, Master Science, PhD. This is very common platform. Well, the way is uncommon. The road that I chose, it is uncommon, or people, they scare about that. So I will just showing my 10th mark sheet. In Oxford University, we have only two Marathi scientists. They all belongs from the ZP school, including me, and another one who is the anesthetist in my hospital. He's a Marathi guy. And one Marathi joined from Karjat. He is also from the rural background. So I have just 70% with very simple score. So we don't need very highly clever people in research. Even vaccine scientist, she was failed in her one score module. Even in 12th, I have very simple score, but I have more marks in biology than physics. But I choose the physics because society people advise me we don't have future in biology, so go to the physics or mathematics. At least in BSc or after MSc you will get some job, but in biology you will not get. That was the truth. Then after the time, when I started my master in physics, I went to the physics PhD in interdisciplinary subject. My supervisor pushed me to choose something different 10 years ago. that the future after 10 or 20 years will be interdisciplinary research. So choose now. And then I choose some simple biological problems we can solve using the physics. Even I don't have any background of biology after 12th, even chemistry as well. So I choose because I scare about the chemical reaction. So I excluded that subject in my BSc. Well, after my PhD, my first job is in Samsung Biomedical Institute in School of Medicine. And there, my all colleagues, they are microbiologists, they are biotechnologists, molecular biologists, they were doctors, they are animal doctors and human doctors as well. All kind of researchers were there. So then I started to grab the knowledge from biology, medicine. And that time I was working on the cancer and infectious diseases, like bacterial infections. So these bacterial infections are from hospital-acquired bacterial infection. Like recently, we have some issue of mucormycosis, that fungus. Actually, it comes through the hospitals. Most of the hospitals, they are infected with such kind of fungus. And when patients get admitted, they attack on them. So we work on such kind of bacteria. They are already in hospitals. And when some patients, cancer patient or other patient, they are for their surgery or diabetic patient, they attack on them. And they are immunosuppressed. So most of the cancer patient after surgery, they die. Not because of the cancer, but because of the disease that we call the sepsis, which is because of this kind of bacteria. So we are working on that and the cancer together in Korea. The same problem I solved, or I was working in the physics department in Ireland and Germany, almost 3 years. So here, most of the colleagues were physicists, chemists, pharmacists. So the same topic, same kind of research we are doing, but the surrounding were changed. So when surrounding changes, our idea changes, our thinking changes. So now here I was thinking, or my solution is more towards the engineering way. Earlier it was more towards the medical way. Well, in my third position, when I got funded by the European Commission in Switzerland and Poland, I worked in biomedical engineering division in Poland and Switzerland, and we are solving the same problems. But here I was more experienced with the animal experiments. You will be surprised to know that I was worked with the doctors who are brain specialists, they are psychologists, they are surgeons, they are kind of health policymakers, but they are not for humans. They are for animals. You'll be surprised to know that in the world, only 4 hospitals, they are called the GLP accredited hospitals, good lab practices. So the drug or technology tested in that hospital, FDA gives permission within 1 day because of their culture in that hospitals. So I worked with that scientist in University of Zurich. So it is one of that hospital. And I worked with the brain specialist of mice and dogs and horses. I worked with the surgeon, a lady who made 7,000 surgery of her horses across the globe. Her patients coming from the USA, from Turkey, Spain, UK, and they are all horses, sheeps. And that hospital is one of the rich hospital in Switzerland. So there I got more medical knowledge. Even as a physicist, there I understand the clinical things, biomedical things, and fundamentals of that. And at the end, now I'm working in the University of Oxford in a medicine department. I work with the women who are very much crazy after pregnancy and delivery, that we don't know they have the kind of syndrome, depression after post-delivery. And we work with them. Side by side, we do the work on the small children cancer, their brain cancer. We are using some new technologies. That was the rule or the law that was discovered by the Raman, who is Indian scientist, 100 years ago. Still, we are using the same technology to solve the medical problems. And probably in next 10 years, you will find some MRI kind of machinery in the operation room where you can find the tumor and normal tissues easily on the monitor. So we don't need to be a MRI and CT scan every day or every time for patients. Even in during the surgery, it is the one of the most difficult tasks to identify the borders between tumor and normal cells. And that's why most of the surgeon, they don't cut all the area or the tumor. They always keep some millimeter or some millimeter or sometimes micrometer. And that means they are keeping millions of cancer cells live there, and they grow again. That we call the relapse. And that's why when you have a cancer, it is exactly opposite to the COVID. So once you have the COVID, there are very few chances that you will get infected again with the COVID. But once we have the cancer, there is a 99.9% chances that even your cancer is cured, it will be coming back. Maybe 5 years, 10 years, or 20 years. I have my patients, they have breast cancer after 20 years. So they get diagnosed 20 years ago, they get cured, they've lived very well, and now they are again. And in the second time, only 5% survival rate across the globe because of this difficulty in surgeries, diagnosis, and therapeutics. And we are working on such a platform to solve this issue. We are not just alone in the world. More than, I would say, 10,000 researchers across the globe, they are solving the same problem. Well, this is kind of interdisciplinary journey when I started from physics to the biology. So what I achieved and in the medicine. So in terms of academics, academics are judged by their publications, like research papers, books. So we have more than 60 articles, research articles in high impact factor journals, very specific journals, medicine or material science related. We have books. I have more than 10 lakh rupees of royalty got by these books. Even not books or the publications, we have invented the technology. And we set a startup in Poland, and the second startup we are thinking in Pune as well. So for the cancer. So not only academic research, we are working with some advanced technologies as well. Well, how we are doing it? With the support of our institutes from the globe. So every university where I work, they always have such kind of departments to encourage us. But they might have science technology units, intellectual property right units, and technology transfer units. So when we work in such kind of basic sciences, where we are doing the experiments on cells or some using lasers or using some computer programs, how we can commercialize that? So there are some steps. So we have to find the market of our technology, even for our research. Then advantages over other our competitors and commercialization. So we need a team for that, because researcher, they have more focused on the generating knowledge. They are not businessmen. They are not market-oriented guys who know the market, who know the how to sell our product. So we need such kind of team. And most of the universities in Europe and even in Korea, Japan, they have such kind of offices. Well, this is something new for all of you. Most of us, we always think that I will implement my research into technology, I will develop some technology. But what technology? Is that technology is internationally competed? Can it compete with the international products? If no, then how we can compete? So we have to know some international regulations for technologies. So most of the international regulation comes under the technology readiness levels. Means your ideas, they call it is a TRL, So most of our research that we do in the lab in India, they have TRL zero. If you want to be a technology, it must be a TRL 9. Sometime it is TRL 10. It starts from TRL 1 to 10. Most of the European research in TRL 3, even not TRL 4. Most of the US research is in between TRL 3 and 4. Korea, Singapore, China, and Hong Kong, they are in between TRL 4 to 5. We have to now fulfill this barrier. If you have to commercialize and make the money from product, not money, it must be like a vaccine. Within a year, it is circulated for 3 billion people. So they know this kind of TRLs. We have to set up such kind of offices and human resource in each university. They will understand. If some researcher from university will come to that office and will say, I have this research ideas, I have some data, and now I want to make a prototype or commercialize my idea, immediately this officer will understand what is the TRL of his idea. And then he will say, okay, you have to work more and then come again. Because if your idea is below TRL 3, it won't work, it won't commercialize easily. We have to always focus on the TRL 4 to 5. Then there are easy chances that it means to be a commercialized in very short time. So we work, even we are struggling to get TRL 5 in Europe. One of our technology that was awarded by the European Commission, it is now in TRL 7. So we made a tie-up with the industry and we have now product ready. Just we are taking the more animal studies and the responses from our peer criticism from US and other countries. And probably within next 5 years, it will take almost 5 years to get a TRL 9. So it's not that easy. When you have going from TRL 0 to TRL 3 takes 3 to 4 months. And then the real picture starts. So this should be implemented in our research context. Then we can implement or then we can design the inventions that are internationally compatible. And for that, we need support from the government. So if any institutes, if they have some commercialization framework, this is real picture of the commercialization. Most of the government universities, they believe that they are in high TRL, but not. They have the real gap between them and the private sector. Because working culture of universities and private sector is exactly opposite. In Ireland, I worked with the Pfizer company, who is the manufacturer of Pfizer vaccine and the other pharma products for 1 year. So there I understand how private people work. So what they need, what they require from you. So as institutes or academics, we always have more freedom for our thinking. We have room to criticism and we have more room to implement our ideas. While in industry, it is not. Even they give you the one protocol and they say, okay, we have to go with this protocol. Some people like me, or somebody from your side, if they are researcher, they will think that this protocol takes 10 days to complete this process. I will minimize this protocol and I can finish within 5 days. So I can save the 5 days. But industrialist, they say, no, 10 days means 10 days. We don't want to save time. If we want to save time, we have to invest for some infrastructure that we won't have. So don't implement your ideas. Use your skills only and implement that protocols. In academics research, it won't work. In academics, it is exactly opposite. If you have a protocol given by your some colleagues or seniors, your role is to change that protocol, something find new in that protocol. Research means something search new in same thing again and again. So bringing these two sectors together is very, very tough job. Not in India. It's very difficult in India. But even in Europe and US, because industrial mindset is different, and the institute or the researcher, they work in the university, their mindset is different. So this tough task we have to now, this is a two different mountains, and we have to cross it. Well, how we can do it? If we have a good team, I always believe that good team makes a change. So if we have such kind of team who will analyze, understand our ideas, visualize our ideas to the audience or the market, execute ideas, evaluate ourselves, and finalize follow-up with different processes. So like when I worked in the Wrocław University of Science and Technology in Poland, they have this type of offices who were supporting to researchers and academics, and they are making tie-up with industries. So every week, we are have the meetings with the industrialists in Europe and in USA, in different, and they are mostly startup companies. So if we set up such kind of offices, we can go. But the problem is that we don't have that kind of skilled people. That's the problem. Who will understand this all international processes? So we have to make this kind of human resources by education or arranging workshop, talks, schools, conferences. It's not that easy that we can set up easily. Even these institutes, they took 10 years to set up such kind of offices. Yeah. So this is our team across the globe with whom I'm working. We have now more collaborators from Harvard and Yale Medical School. So I always believe research comes through the collaboration and cooperation. Nobody can claim that I'm doing alone and this is my own research. This Covishield vaccine was developed by the Sarah Gilbert, but her team is consisting around 380 researchers. More than 14 Indian researchers are working there. 27 nationalities are there. So it comes through the collaboration. The time has gone, then somebody will develop or somebody will invent only Newton's laws or Einstein theories. Now it's impossible. So collaboration makes the best use of your talent to implement ideas, to discuss, and to way forward. So with this, I'll be stopping, and I always believe on the two-way knowledge transfer. So I would be happy to take your questions. We'll discuss, because I didn't forget that. You might forget about that, but I get trained with that. So every time you have to take the questions from audience, try to convince them, try to understand them and yourself as well. So thank you very much. And please ask questions if you have.
If there are any questions, anyone can ask.
Yeah, please freely ask. Yeah. Don't be bothered.
You can circulate mic.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir, and great to know you. I had a very basic question. What is the exact difference between humanities and social sciences from the
well,
point
so
of view?
It's, I don't have background with the humanities and social sciences, but I will give the one example how humanities and social sciences, if they come together, how we can change the health system. So I'm working with one hospital in Aurangabad and with doctors, and we set one international center, multidisciplinary center, where we have around 14 research domains: biomedical engineering, nano engineering, artificial intelligence, mechatronics, and humanities, social science, creative art as well. So humanities more deal with the best ways and policies of the human and humankind. The social sciences, they are more about the behavior of people. So like political science or social science itself has some subjects and modules. Even history comes under that. Economics comes under that. Humanities is mostly more on the understanding the concept of humans, how they are evolving, and the market together. Like we have MBA courses, business management, or some others. They come under the humanities and these social sciences. When they work together, they can change many things. But we don't have such kind of trained, skilled people who understand their subjects and the value of their subjects. So most of the social scientists, they think that we don't have future. But you know, all political parties across the globe, they have the team, thinkers, and they all are social scientists. You know the Cambridge Analytica part, and Oxford has a special department, information center department, and every year they publish the report on the how these social scientists changing the world and politics. Now the health will be the most important factor in the world politics. So after 10 years, the most of the parties or the manifestos, they will have the health priorities. Otherwise, they will gone. People are very now curious. They are aware about their health. They are conscious about health. So these people has come together, how to come together and how to work together. So they can be a policy makers.
Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
So thank you for the wonderful session. Actually, I have two questions. The first thing is how you have tried to apply the knowledge of physics to address the biological problem.
Yeah.
Okay. And my second question is, as you have worked with the many people where the interdisciplinary people are involved into your research, so the question from my end is what sort of brainstorming generally happen to get down the people on the common platform to discuss that problem?
Yeah, I will answer the second question first. So I'm working in medical school. We have around 10 laboratory members. And I'm supervising two. And they are medical doctors. They are MD students. So even I don't have a medical degree, every day we discuss in the lab. Though I am supervising them, I always ask them medical questions that I don't have. And they always answer it. Sometimes I do my experiments and they say this is wrong, it is not ethical, or it will not work because in medicine or human physiology, anatomy is different. Your physics is different. You can apply it outside the body, but you don't know the inside the body, what is that. You never seen the people, never treated the patient. You never did the dissection or the, you know, that postmortem thing. So you don't know the physiology, anatomy, and I agree with that, always. So this kind of culture we have, and most of the universities in the globe, they have. Otherwise, we can't do the interdisciplinary research. We have to learn from others as well. They might be our students, juniors, sometimes they are seniors as well. We always argue with my boss as well. So sometimes he asking us to do that, to make this kind of, and most of the students say, we work in the lab, we know the problems, it will not happen, it won't work there. So this happens there, nobody believes, nobody thinks that it is an egoistic thing. My junior is giving me the advice. So for interdisciplinary, we need this culture. Now I'll come to the second question, first question, what physics we are doing in the medicine. So mostly physics, what we are doing, you know the MRI machine, it generates the high magnetic field. That magnetic field sends the hydrogen atoms spin off, like magnetic field with the hydrogen atom, which is in our blood or in our body, and they give us the image after processes, that is the MRI image. So it's all is the magnetic field. We use the similar kind of magnetic field to hit the material inside the body so they can kill the cancer cells. So our normal body temperature is the 37 degrees centigrade. Tumor has the same temperature. If we hit the tumor around 42 to 46, over the time, tumor cells, they die, slowly die. That we call the apoptosis. They slowly die, means they will die within week or 2 weeks. Well, how to generate that temperature within the body? That's the tough problem. So we use the magnetic field, because magnetic field is non-invasive. It don't harm. So we can trace that. We use the some magnetic materials to guide through the blood to the tumor. So they have some biomolecule. So they will sense the tumor and they will go into the tumor only. So this is called the targeted delivery. This Pfizer, Moderna, and Oxford vaccines, they are targeted vaccines. That's why their efficiency is higher. So the similar technology we are using to guide these materials in the body and use the magnetic field, so we can generate the heat within the tumor only. And we can kill it. But controlling the heat is another parameter. We are working on that. This is a simple question. It's very difficult when we deal with the patients. So we are doing the animal trials on mice, dogs. And we succeed not only with the magnetic field, but we are using the laser light as well. So that technology recently awarded by the Innovation Radar Prize, European Commission, and we have now started our own startup to commercialize this technology. Some companies in the Germany and US, they are doing similar kind of research. So we work on that as well. Also, I mentioned that I work on the bacterial infections for some sepsis, and those are called the superbugs. So we know the pandemic. It is coming through the viruses, but we don't know the silent pandemic. There is another term that is called the silent pandemic, which is killing people more than this pandemic. So the what silent pandemic, the disease that is because of the bacteria, cancer, diabetes, sugar, these are the diseases. Every day, millions of people dying in the world. But from last 2 years, we are more focused on the COVID. But the scenario will be changing. Now Europe and Americans, they're thinking for the next 50-year plan, how to treat this silent pandemic. Almost 90% population in India has exposed with the antibiotics. And we are now resistant with the antibiotics. We have only 6 and 7 antibiotics, and not a single antibiotics will be discovered for next 30 years. So we have to find the new treatment. Otherwise, everyone will be treated, will be get resistance with the antibiotics. And then if there is a new bacteria that's coming, they are coming from Sahara, they are coming from Himalaya, Alps, Serbia, they are coming from the seas, oceans, because human exposure is more in that region. So if such bacteria will be coming, we don't have the cure treatment. So many industries also investing in. Just 1 month ago, one big investor in oil and gas company in UK, he donated 100 crore rupees to Oxford University to set up an institute who will do the research on the antimicrobial research, so resistance and others. So they are ahead, and he donated, not invested. So the donation means we don't expect any return. So there are some industrialists who think for that humanity. We have to approach such people here also. There are many. And that's why we are setting one health foundation here in Pune that is called the Right to Health. And with the support from Pani Foundation, support from 2 media, Saka, Lokmat, Sam TV and ABP Maza, we will be making awareness across the rural and urban area about health and the future challenges. So cancer, diabetes, antimicrobial resistance, they are challenges for humanity. And somebody has to take a lead in that. We have to find the future for such diseases. And most of our research that I mentioned, this is government funded. We don't get funding from private or crowdfunding. But in UK or Europe or in USA, many people, they donate for research. Like Harvard Medical School, they get every year 1,000 crore rupees from the common people for researcher. Many researcher, Nobel laureates, get money from the common people. If you go on their website, they have links. If you want to donate for my research, just donate it. Same in UK, even my lab in the UK, we got 1 crore rupees every year from brain charity. They fund for us to do the research in the labs. Not a single institute in India who is getting such kind of money. And that's why our second motto is, with that foundation, to bring the money from public for the public. So cancer, diabetes is their threat. So we will be setting such labs with the support from universities within the region of Pune, Aurangabad and Kolhapur initially, who are interested to support such activities. We are setting such kind of labs, public funded labs. So institutes has to just give us the lab facility or the area. The all facilities, all money we will bring from the public. And I already started such activity in Pune. I'll be starting it in Kolhapur and Aurangabad. So this kind of research culture that Harvard or Oxford have, we want to bring in India. So from 1st of January 2022, we are launching this activity across the Maharashtra. We approached many people, like just 2 days ago, I met Krishna Prakash in Pimpri Chinchwad. He's doing many health activities. And I said, just give me 2 days, your 2 days for me. And do one marathon, do one swimming activity to make the public awareness. And we'll advise people, we'll ask people to donate for us. So in many developed countries, such athletics, players, or health conscious people, they generate money for research. So one of my colleagues, he lost his mother for breast cancer. So three months ago, he swam around 40 miles. And he generated £50,000 money. It's around 50 lakh rupees for our research, lab research. So we are awaring people now to do this type of activities as well.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, we are having our applied science department under College of Engineering, and this year we are starting with the MSc program in the applied sciences also. So I just want to know from you, with your diverse background in India as well as abroad, that how do you feel what is the difference between the methodology which is being used to teach the students at the master's program or the PhD program in India and outside?
We are more theoretical based, they are more on practical based. So that's why out of 8 vaccines were developed by the European and Americans, because they are more on practical. We are very strong in the theory, like maths, computer science. But if ask some students to do the engineering experiments, they don't like it. So we are not mean to be, or we are not trained for the experimental things. So that is the real difference between even basic courses and the applied courses.
Okay, thank you.
Right on PCL, Zero 9 was really you had talked about research between medicine and other fields. But what about the arts and performing arts? We have a school of arts and performing arts where music, drama, painting, sculpture. I think that therapies are also not now being used in treating patients. So do you have any experience on that?
Unfortunately not in that area. And when I was a student, I get failed in the art, Chitrakala. So then I said, this is not for me. So then always I think that these artists or these branches, they are really superior and they are for the humanity, but we don't understand their values. So I would say if you get some expertise in their field, it's better to set such kind of interdisciplinary between them as well. मी एक मराठी मध्ये एग्जांपल देईन. हेल्थ डॉक्टर आपले इकॉनॉमिक्स हा एक आता पॅरामीटर आपल्या हेल्थमध्ये येतो आहे आणि यायला पाहिजे. कालच मी एका सांगली जिल्ह्यातील डॉक्टरांच्या मीटिंगमध्ये होतो, त्यावेळी त्यांना हे सांगितलं आणि त्यावेळी त्यांना समजलं हे असं असते. डॉक्टर आणि सायंटिस्ट यांच्यामध्ये एक फरक असतो. डॉक्टरांच्या दारात ज्यावेळी पेशंट येतो त्यावेळी ते ट्रीटमेंट देतात आणि दारातून निघून जातो त्यावेळी ते त्याला विसरून जातात. तो यायच्या आधी काय होता, आल्यानंतर काय असेल याचा त्याच्याशी काही संबंध नसतो. कोविडच्या बाबतीत हे 100% सत्य आहे. कोविडचा पेशंट त्यांच्याजवळ येतो, ते डायग्नोसिस करतात, ट्रीटमेंट देतात. तो येण्यापूर्वी त्यानं किती जणांना इन्फेक्ट केलं कुणालाही माहीत नाही, कारण डॉक्टर म्हणतात ते आमचं काम नाही, आम्हाला त्याच्याबद्दलचं नॉलेज नाही. पण तुम्ही त्याला ट्रीटमेंट देऊन बाहेर सोडल्यानंतर तो कुणाला इन्फेक्ट करतो आहे की नाही किंवा त्याची सिच्युएशन काय होते हे त्यांच्याकडे नसतं. सायंटिस्ट हे पाहतात, तुम्हाला ट्रीटमेंट काय दिली जाते हे हा भाग वेगळा आहे. पण त्या फील्डमधले इन्फेक्शियस डिसीज मॅनेजमेंटचे जे सायंटिस्ट असतात ते पहिल्यांदा हे बघतात की या पेशंटने किती जणांना इन्फेक्ट केलं असेल, करू शकेल, आणि त्यावरून ते आपल्याला आत्ता समजायला लागलं. अशा प्रकारचे इन्स्टिट्यूट जर्मनीमध्ये किंवा कोरियामध्ये 25 वर्षापासून आहेत. सो इकॉनॉमिक्स कसं प्ले करतं पहा. एक दोन पेशंट आहेत एकाच डॉक्टरकडे येत आहेत, दोघांचं एज सेम आहे, दोघेही मेल असतील किंवा फिमेल असतील, दोघांनाही सेम डिसीज आहे, सेम प्रॉब्लेम आहे. डॉक्टर हा विचार करतो दोघांनाही सेम ट्रीटमेंट देऊया. त्यातील एक पेशंट आहे तो एकदम गरीब आहे झोपडपट्टीतील, त्याच्या मनामध्ये हा विचार चाललेला असतो की मी डॉक्टरांच्याकडे गेलं मला एक इंजेक्शन देतील, एक 2 दिवसाच्या गोळ्या देतील, मला बरं वाटलं पाहिजे, कारण माझ्याकडे तेवढा वेळ नाही आहे 3-4 दिवस घरी राहायचं, कारण माझं काम थांबेल, माझ्याकडे तेवढे पैसे नाहीत पुन्हा पुन्हा इथं यायसाठी. त्याची एक मानसिकता अशी झालेली असते की मला एका ट्रीटमेंट डोसमध्ये मी बरा झालो पाहिजे, कदाचित तो होतो. त्याचबरोबर असा एक श्रीमंत, एक सुपर रिच व्यक्ती त्याच डॉक्टरकडे येतो, त्याच्याकडेसुद्धा एक गोष्ट नसते वेळ. तोसुद्धा हाच विचार करतो की माझ्याकडं वेळ नाही आहे आता 2 दिवस बेडवर झोपण्याची किंवा पुन्हा पुन्हा इथे येण्याची, मी आत्ता पाहिजे तेवढे पैसे द्यायला तयार आहे, पण एकाच ट्रीटमेंट डोसमध्ये मी बरा झाला पाहिजे. सो त्याची मानसिकता वेगळी असते. ह्या दोन लोकांच्या मानसिकता वेगळ्या असतात, दोघांना सेम दिलं जातं, कदाचित दोघांना सेम इफेक्ट दिसतो ड्रगचा. ज्यावेळी एकाच घरातील 2 पेशंट जातात सेम डिसीजला, दोघांना सेम ट्रीटमेंट दिली तरी सेम आउटपुट मिळत नाही. हा जो फॅक्टर आहे तो येतो इकॉनॉमिक्समधून, कारण त्या 2 लोकांची इकॉनॉमी वेगळी होती पण त्यांची मानसिकता पण वेगळी झाली, म्हणून त्या ट्रीटमेंटला रिस्पॉन्स देण्याची मानसिकता किंवा बॉडीचा जो रिस्पॉन्स असतो, इम्युनिटीचा असेल किंवा त्या ऑर्गनचा असेल किंवा होल बॉडी सिस्टीमचा असेल, तो मॅटर करतो. म्हणून आता हेल्थमध्ये इकॉनॉमी हा एक पॅरामीटर ॲड करायला पाहिजे, आणि इंडियासारख्या कंट्रीमध्ये तर तो असायलाच पाहिजे. त्यामुळं ज्या युनिव्हर्सिटीमध्ये हेल्थ रिलेटेड आहे आणि इकॉनॉमिस्ट आहेत त्यांनी एकत्र आलंच पाहिजे, कारण ते म्हणतील आमचं कामच नाही एकत्र येण्याचं. पण एका उदाहरणावरून असे हजारो उदाहरणं आहेत की आर्ट, सायन्स आणि इंजिनिअरिंग या लोकांनी एकत्र आलंच पाहिजे. वॅक्सिन डेव्हलपमेंट होता, ड्रग डेव्हलपमेंट होता, त्यामध्ये फक्त सायंटिस्ट नसतात, त्यामध्ये बिझनेस लोक असतात, लोकांचं माइंड समजणारी सोशल सायंटिस्ट असतात. इंग्लंडनं हा प्रयोग केला, ज्यावेळी वॅक्सिन दिली त्यावेळी त्यांनी लॉकडाऊन लावलं आणि लॉकडाऊनमध्ये वॅक्सिन दिलं लोकांना संपूर्ण, आणि मग बाहेर सोडलं. त्यांनी सोशल सायन्सचा एक एक्सपेरिमेंट केला की जर लॉकडाऊनमध्ये जर आपण लोकांना वॅक्सिन दिलं तर त्यांची एक मेंटॅलिटी होईल, हे काहीतरी भयानक आहे, आपल्याला घरात बसून दिलं जातं आहे, ज्यावेळी आपण बाहेर पडू त्यावेळी आपल्याला एक काहीतरी खात्रीशीर इलाज मिळाला पाहिजे. आणि त्या मेंटॅलिटीवर, सोशल बिहेवियरवर इंग्लंडमध्ये आजसुद्धा 3rd वेव चालू आहे, पण जर रोज 25,000-30,000 केसेस असतील तर 20 किंवा 25 डेथ आहेत. म्हणजे त्यांनी वॅक्सिनचं, फक्त वॅक्सिन सायन्स न वापरता सोशल सायन्स वापरून यावरती कंट्रोल घेतला, कारण इंग्लंडच्या पंतप्रधानांची जी टीम आहे त्यामध्ये हे मेंबर आहेत, सोशल सायंटिस्ट, बिहेवियरल सायंटिस्ट. सो ही लोक अशा पद्धतीने एकत्र येऊ शकतात.
थँक्यू नानासाहेब, थँक्यू फॉर गिविंग अ सच अ वंडरफुल लेक्चर. आय थिंक एव्हरी वन हियर इज रिअली गॉट यु नो एनलाइटन्ड बाय दी आयडियाज ऑफ द रिसर्च अँड हाऊ वी कॅन क्रिएट द रिसर्च, बिकॉज since last 1 year or number of people are working in these areas for number of years, but at this university since last 1 year we are trying to find out the way how can we create the research culture at our university. So your lecture is like a vaccine. At the right time, you have delivered this research vaccine to our this faculty. They will certainly get cured by the syndrome or the belief that the research is not possible in our university. And for research, I think very genius people are required. So very simple concepts by giving simple example of yourself and other examples like in this interdisciplinary research approach, we may have to learn from juniors. So that factor also is there. How I'm talking without knowing much about the so deeper parameters about the research, but no, because I have not studied any case study of the research, but by general, reading, I had come to conclusion because we have to merge all the faculties. They have to come together, they have to work together, and how can we go ahead? That is a real quest which is taken by this university. And when Dr. Gawaneji, he told me, very young researcher from our Sangli is working in Oxford, and he will certainly give, or he will ignite the people at our university. So I'm very happy. You are really true son of India, I can say. But you are on the right track because we have to be knowledge creator. And most happy part is that you are going to give it back to our country. You are coming here, you are sharing your thoughts, you are motivating people to go on that track is a very important thing. He just in a short interaction at my office, he told the story about the D.Y. Patil University, medical university. In 2008, that university was rejected because they were not at par in the research. So 44 universities, they were supposed to be barred or debarred by the UGC. They had declared. Then in one bathroom, they started the research department. And the research of radiology, physics and medical science, radiology department. And now they are doing, I think, 4 to 5 crore rupees, they spend the money and they got a lot of funds from the Department of Energy, Atomic Energy. So if we have the will, we can find out the way. Fund is not the problem. As what we are doing little in the entrepreneurship is recognized by the government of India. They have, without knowing they granted the further funds. Only our belief system has to be changed. And sincere efforts has to be done. Here, Nana Sahib, the real issue is that everyone understands it. This type of research culture is required. But issue is the ego of faculty is there. Who will go to whom? Why I will go to? Because I am senior. See, the audience is so less. This cannot be. I cannot put the gun on their head and you have to come there. But still, I told Bhojwaneji, phone them, let them come. Issue is that unless when MIT whole education in this globalized world, now the students have the option to go to any university, the foreign universities are going to come at our in our country. In that condition, are we going to set up our universities in that direction? Are we really going to, or are we going to work with the colonial mind, the same way, the same education system, only degree producing education system? So these questions are to be asked by all the leaders, head of the institution, because I'm a mechanical engineer. I do not know anything about the computer. I do not know anything about the other field. But everyone has to ask the question, and we can't work to, impress people. We have to impress our own self. Am I doing justice to my commitment? If I have taken some commitment, some pledge, have I really worked on that pledge? So that question is to be asked. He was talking to me, Oxford has 80 departments. In medical science only they have, how many departments? 40. Yeah, 21 divisions. So on cancer, heart, there are so many challenges in medical sciences, in every field. And Oxford is the number one. There is a competition in Oxford and Cambridge. Oxford produces leaders. They are more famous for producing leaders of global level. And the Cambridge is more famous for the science. They produce more the Nobel laureates, like that.
So we should have the competitive spirit. We should take up that challenge. And for research, I think we have to take up. I know the time, we cannot make that big miracle in a short time. But we can set up any center of excellence in any area with the physics, medical sciences, because health is going to be the priority of all governments in coming years because of the more population, our human interference at all places which were virgin prior to these years. We are going there and we are disturbing the ecosystem. So more and more challenges are going to come there. So I think MIT has to take up that lead. We have to really create those centers of excellences. We are trying to. I will request you can work as our advisor. Even though you are young, I think there is nothing wrong. Our people should not feel there is nothing wrong in taking advice. How good HR policies are to be set up to create that ecosystem is our challenge. How, recently we did the leadership lecture from one of the lady Indira Parikh. My efforts are to make our, leaders more active. Their windows should be opened, more ventilating, their minds has to be ventilated. The old suffocating, the ambience there has to be removed from their mind. It is not their mistake because it is the culture in which everyone has grown in our country. They carry the same belief. I have to behave like that. When saas bhi kabhi bahu the, mere saas ne aisa kiya, toh main aisa hi karungi. Ye khayal nikalna chahiye. In academics, he rightly pointed out one good example. How we, every institution, is a politically activated. In our university also groupism is there. In every department, we do groupism, favorism. Then that person leaves the job. He leaves the organization. Then how we can bring the talent? How many times we can bring the talent to the organization? That question has to be asked. I have to be comfortable. So that, I think, these syndromes have to be removed from our mind and we have to work. Then only I think we can walk on that path, at least, few meters, I can say, in coming 10 years or 15 years. So I think with that angle, this lecture will certainly help us. I'm not saying our people are trying to do much good work. Yeah, it is our duty to give more time for the research work, more time for academics. We have to reduce their administrative work, other work. I agree on that. So I'm trying to you all, we have made the committees. I have to listen to the views of the committee. But we have to slowly evolve, new university, new generation university, which can really set the good example in this part of the country. And people should really see towards us that MIT is really, maintaining some, or trying to bring the new model of education. We cannot copy the same way the Oxford is doing, but we have to find out. Customization has to be made as per our body size, like the tailor, he stitches the clothes. So likewise, considering our, behavior and other factors, we have to do some customization. But I'm very happy, Nana Sahibji, I think we will have more and more interaction. We will certainly... in our next interactions, I think Dr. Rawande, Dr. Bhojwani is there. We have already set up one innovation department, but I know the time, as you rightly said, the 10 years are required to set up that department, how the technology can be commercialized. But one small step is taken in that direction. I'm happy people are at least started thinking in that direction. They are applying for the copyright, that ecosystem, innovation, IP, the training is given to everyone. So I think today's meeting is a very good meeting. Like-minded, partners are here. And certainly we will grow our, relationship and our partnership. And our founder always says MIT want to, we are also MIT. Somebody should refer, after 30 years, MIT from India is doing really good work. In their speeches. So with that motive, I think MIT, ADT University, MIT group is working. So once again, I am very thankful to you and we are looking forward for much and much early interaction and better interaction. Thank you very much.
So last week, our Honorable Vice Chancellor instructed to connect with Dr. Nana Sahib, and then we had an interaction, a very nice and comfortable interaction with Nana Sahib. He told, don't worry, I'll be managing my own travel, you don't have to worry, I'll be there on your gate. So no formalities required. So even when we met today morning, he was very easy to go along with. So I was with Dr. Pawar sir with him. And thank you all of you, all the HODs, deans who have made it for the today's event. Everybody is busy, yes, but that's why we communicated well in advance. Last week morning also we sent a reminder. Thank you all for making up time for this important interaction. Since we have great visionaries with us who do visit, so it's a luck for us when somebody from Oxford, Cambridge, they come to our campus. म्हणजे काही लोकांचे पावलं जरी पडले तरी ती धरती पुण्य होते, तसं ते आहे. म्हणजे सांगलीतनं जतमधून कोणतरी एवढं जिल्हा परिषदमधून ऑक्सफर्डला जातो, इट्स अ बिग एक्झाम्पल की देर इज नो कॉन्व्हेंट असो, CBSE असो, इट डझंट मॅटर. इट्स द ॲटिट्यूड, इट्स द हार्डवर्क पुट इन बाय पीपल दॅट मेक्स देम ग्रेट, दॅट टेक्स देम टू द हाईट. सो वी बाय होल हार्टेडली वी थँक डॉक्टर नानासाहेब हू हॅज अग्रीड. He was supposed to visit WPU, but he cancelled and he agreed to come to ADT today. He is also having a visit to WPU tomorrow, I think. Yeah. Yeah.
It was a big mess with them. So then I asked the officer, which one is better? And he says, of course, this one. So I
prefer. So he has a busy scheduling.
Yeah, but yeah. He advised me to come here first.
More passionate here.
Yeah. And thank you, Dr. Mangesh Karat, sir, for initiating this interaction. And we hope we have more interaction with Dr. Nana Sahib and people of his caliber. Thank you all. Thank you all for making time. Thank you.
Thank you.